Okay, let's begin today's program with invocation. I invite Ms. Bhumika, third year BSc Physics.
Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarubini Vidyarambam Karikshyami Siddhir Pavadume Sada Padma Patra Vishalakshi Padma Keshara Varnini Nityam Padmalaya Devi Samam Pada Saraswati.
Good morning, one and all. On behalf of Department of Physics, DG Vaishnav College, I extend a warm welcome to today's webinar. Our department has been organizing seminars, science outreach programs under the banner of LLX Science Club. Our club is registered bronze club under Vigyan Prasan, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, to progress in fields of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Collaboration and engagement at different level globally is very essential. Global competence suggests the ability to recognize one's responsibility to both the local and global communication and to develop and apply knowledge in culturally appropriate ways. This talk aims to introduce the strategies and methods to incorporate self-awareness for personal growth. We have gathered here virtually for this webinar on self-awareness for personal growth as an attempt to develop interpersonal skills and awareness about oneself. I extend my warm welcome to our resource person, Madam Priya Veeraraghavan, ICF Certified Leadership Psychotherapist, co-founder Punctuate Consulting Bangalore, who has agreed to deliver the talk today. I extend my warm welcome to the secretary and a principal of our college to this webinar. Also, I welcome the professors and my fellow students participants from our college and other institutions. Now I invite Ms. Akshaya Lakshmi of third year BSc Physics to introduce the speaker.
Our resource person, Madam Priya Veeraraghavan, holds an MBA and a master's in psychology. She has worked with several distinguished corporate establishments in key strategic leadership roles. She has been piloting organization development, culture and change initiatives, and HR business partnership. Close to a decade back, she co-founded Punctuate Consulting, which specializes in redefining the way organization and institution operates and helping them in creating best workplaces. Alongside this, our invitee, Madam Priya Veeraraghavan, found her calling for working with people, offering a space for reflection, exploration, and growth of clients as a trainee, coach, and a psychotherapist. She continues to work with the individual and groups in her practice as a psychotherapist and coach. Curious and passionate about learning, growing, and discovering different sides to her, she keeps experimenting with new subjects, concepts, and frameworks. She is also a reader, writer, and a flautist. Welcome you, ma'am. We are happy to have you as a resource person, eagerly waiting for your session. Over to you, ma'am.
Good morning again, and if any of you missed my New Year wishes, so again, a very happy New Year to everyone. So I'm really glad to have made it today for this session, because this is one of my favorite topics, and on the Adhikala Glenda, this is one topic that has been explored time and again by so many professionals, like from philosophers to psychologists to off late neuroscientists and even physicists. So I'm not aware if anyone of you have read recent research trends on quantum physics and consciousness, right? So there is, there are scientific evidences that they're coming up with on the entire field of awareness and consciousness itself. So it is one big, huge topic and very interesting and trending topic. Yeah, so so while that's on the topic, I also thought I'll, so all of you know me, so I'm thankful for the introduction that was given by you people, but I don't know you. And the problem is in this kind of media, I'm not physically present to see all of you. So I was just wondering if we can have a very quick round of not introductions, but just a few questions for which you can maybe just unmute yourself and just respond. And don't worry about who's going first, who's going second. Just go ahead with your choice. The noise is welcome. I really don't mind the noise if 2-3 people speak together again, right? Okay, so quick things. So why physics? Why did you all choose physics?
Because I like physics.
Okay, what do you like specifically about physics?
Like knowing all the theories and everything behind what's happening around us.
Wow.
It has an answer to everything.
Kunal, yes.
It is the most fundamental thing that can explain all the things happening in the universe.
Super. Yeah, it's a lot of study of natural phenomena, right? From time to gravity, name it, anything. Yeah. What else?
It describes the nature.
Ma'am, I just choose physics because I love ballistics, ma'am.
Okay. Interesting. Okay. Okay. Next question. No? I'll just keep this very quick so that we don't end up spending too much time on this. How many of you like to read books? You can raise hand. You can just say yes.
Myself, Harini, I like.
Myself, Pranit, I like, ma'am.
Wow. Okay.
Myself, Dwarkesh, ma'am. I like to read too many books, ma'am.
Okay. What kind of books do you all read? Do you read, how many of you read fiction? Novel?
I mostly read psychology related books and mind developing.
Wow, okay. What else? How many of you read non-fiction, management books, self-help books, spiritual books?
I will know.
Okay. Who else?
From long back, I read a book called Chicken Soup for Teenage Souls.
Okay. Ah, very interesting.
Book. Yeah. Very interesting book, yes.
Yeah. Teenage Souls is really long back, no?
Yeah. Although I forgot, it was really informative, yeah.
Okay. How many of you dance? Who are the dancers in the group?
Bathroom dancing, yes.
Oh, this is the first time I'm hearing bathroom dancing. Okay, how many of you sing?
Myself, Pranit, ma'am. I would sing.
Wow. Okay, how many of you do bathroom singing?
Almost like, most of us are singing.
Most of us, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I think
better we don't listen to that.
How many of you are good in music otherwise? Instruments, you know, picking up notes, writing songs. Anyone with that talent?
I just tried, ma'am, but it all ends in nuisance, ma'am.
Yeah, same, ma'am. I used to learn keyboard and then I didn't go past level 2.
Oh, okay. How many of you listen to music every day? It's like I can't live without music.
Me, ma'am.
I listen regularly, ma'am.
Yeah, I think
I listen to music all day.
Yeah. So many people, that
not like that, ma'am, but I love to listen, ma'am.
Okay.
Every morning, 1 hour.
Superb. It's a very, very healthy way of self-care. In fact, listening to music, being in touch with music, reading books. Yeah. How many of you speak more than one language?
Myself.
Three languages.
Yes, ma'am. Myself.
What? English, Tamil, and Hindi? What else?
Ma'am, now I'm trying to.
English, Tamil.
Now I'm trying to learn Spanish, ma'am.
Spanish also.
Okay. German, ma'am.
Okay, German. Okay. Abhijit, you were saying something.
Yes, ma'am. Now I'm trying to learn Spanish.
Oh, wow. Okay. How many of you know Hindi? How many of you know who are good in Hindi as well?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. How many of you watch movies?
Mostly repeated movies only, ma'am.
Everyone, ma'am.
Jagan has made everybody a movie holic.
Everyone. Okay, superb. So I am glad because there are a lot of things from movies in the presentation. So I'm really happy. Okay. How many of you have siblings, brothers, sisters?
Myself, brother.
Yes, ma'am. I have a brother.
Okay, how many of you have? How many of you don't have siblings? The only child people. Noah. Okay. Okay. How many of you aspire to pursue PG in physics itself?
Me, ma'am.
Me too, ma'am.
Okay, superb. Anyone who's looking at different aspirations other than physics after graduation?
Yes, ma'am.
What is it?
Degree in international relations, political science, so on, ma'am.
Okay, so you, for you, this topic is bang on. Okay. Anyone wanting to do MBA?
Article science, ma'am.
Oh, article. Okay, fine. Cool. Okay. So something a little closer to your own self now that we're getting into that topic. What do you think are your strengths? And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you to name your strengths. Name one strength that you think is your, you know, very strong suit.
Staying always positive. Curious about the things that happen.
Okay. Staying positive. Devang, what did you say?
Curious about the things and why they happen.
Curiosity. Absolutely. And I'm not surprised that you want to do PG in physics. Okay.
Anyone? Endurance and progress, ma'am.
Endurance. Okay. And very much needed in these times, huh? These pandemic times. Self-recognition. Yeah. Okay.
I'm being patient and thinking positive.
Okay. 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 What is one thing? Yes, I'll hear you. Yes.
Easily adaptable to any nature.
Very good. Adaptability is key. And I think you chose a different field, international relations, no?
No, nautical science.
Article science. Okay. And it's a very important thing in that particular domain as well. Yeah?
Yeah,
of course. How many of you think there is an area of improvement? And what is that? What is something that you want to improve about yourself?
Being a little ambitious.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What else?
Being able to mug up the things.
Is there a possibility? You should have Chyawanprash every day.
There are lots
of formulas. Procrastination.
Okay. Okay. Stop procrastination. Yes. Ramya? Anyone else? What is one area that you think if you improve, you will do really well in life?
Avoid using mobile phone for
not being lazy.
Communication skills.
Yeah, yeah. The avoid using mobile.
Not being lazy.
Not lazy. Absolutely, I agree. What else? Sorry.
To think that there is every positive in every situation.
Okay. So to develop positivity. Okay. Avoid absolutely. I totally agree. Yeah. Okay. One last question. So what is one area that you wish Indians can be better?
Space research.
Okay. Anything else?
Governance, ma'am.
Oh, I bang on. I was just thinking that, Mugilan.
Just ma'am, we are good political economist.
Shiva, yes.
Economist, ma'am.
Okay, yes. IQ, yeah.
Focusing more on the development of technology rather than fighting on small basics.
Totally, I agree, Devang. Yeah, yeah. Okay, cool. So, I think we're good to start. So, I'm going to just move to the presentation slides. Because I'm really glad that this is an interactive crowd, so I'm going to like keep asking questions now and again. Very, very simple quizzes, okay? Small little quizzes, kutty quizzes, yeah? And in these quizzes, there are no right or wrong answers, no negative marking, so feel free to say if you know it, yeah? Is that okay? Cool? Are you all able to see the screen?
Yeah, ma'am, cool.
Yes, ma'am.
Super. Let's just get started. So, I'm not asking who this personality is, but maybe for this generation, I must. Anyone, any guesses who this man is?
M.G. Ramachandran.
Can anyone guess what song this is? This is a clip from a song. Even the teachers can please join in. Because I think our generation...
Let them answer. Google panna pasangala.
Ayyo.
Try pannunga.
This is most popular.
Yeah. And all of you said you listened to music. So let's see.
Like if some clues are given, I can put
it. Ma'am, 90 songs, ma'am. We are 22K kids, ma'am.
Even then, this song is so popular that you can't miss it. But if you don't know, no worries. I'll play it. But I'll give one chance to the teachers if the students come up.
No, it's all, ma'am.
Illappa. Okay. I'm just going to play the song. One second. Apt, no, for our session?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why I said this is a very, very trending and popular topic, which has not lost, its interest levels even in this generation. So I'm going to show you another one. Sorry. Okay, anyone can guess what this song is? The actor?
It's Hrithik Roshan.
Yes.
It's Hrithik Roshan, ma'am.
Yes.
I only know the lyrics. I don't know the name of the full song.
No problem. Is there any one or two words that you can remember?
I think it's Main Aisa Kyun.
Absolutely. Who's the one who spoke? I'm sorry, I can't see the gallery. Who spoke?
I'm Kunal.
Kunal, superb. Yes, this is
It's from film Lakshya.
Absolutely. Yeah,
it's one of my favorite movies.
Wonderful movie about self.
Wonderful movie. Yeah.
Yes, it's about self-discovery and how from being this lazy, pampered, not at all good and serious about life, there is an entire transformation that happens, and he goes on to serve the army. Yeah, so that's the story. And if you have not watched it, you must. I'm just going to play the song for those who are not aware of it. Yeah, app know the lyrics are, and this is something that we all spend time thinking as to why do we do so many things? Why are we doing it the way we are doing? Why are we the way we are? You know, and that's a prominent thought I think everyone at some point go through. Yeah. Okay. This man. Anyone, any guesses who this man is?
Maybe Archimedes or Socrates, ma'am.
Socrates, yes. Who said that?
Mughilan, ma'am.
Okay, Mughilan. Superb. This man is one of the pioneers of self-awareness, the whole concept of self-awareness. And those are his words, know thyself. And this is the temple of Delphi on which, if you see that's the whole thing which is written in Greek, it basically means know thyself. And it's inscribed in the temple of Delphi. And that picture on the right-hand side is the ruins of the temple as of now. And the whole concept of self-awareness started there. And I thought I must share this snippet from history with all of you. Yeah. Okay. So we're good to begin on a more serious note about what this whole, what can be more useful for you in this short session. Yeah. And these are two of my favorite quotes from Socrates. One, which he said, of course, is knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom, which is Aristotle's. And Socrates says, smart people learn from everything and everyone. Average people from their experiences, stupid people already have the answers. So people who assume they know everything, we also call them know-alls. Oh, unakku ella therinjirukku. That category of people, they are the ones who miss out so much on learning and growth. Yeah. Okay. So a quick, short little story. And if you're all wondering why all these pictures are there, there's a bathtub, there's a bucket, there's a mug, and there's a spoon. Okay. So just before getting started there, I just wanted to tell you that all of you, the college is somewhere close to Kid Park, no? Kid Park Mental Hospital? Yeah?
Yes.
Nearby, 2 kilometers.
Okay. So this particular, let's say this incident happened in Kid Park, okay? So this story goes this way. So there is a group of suppliers who were once given a tour of the Kid Park Mental Hospital, okay? And one of the visitors in the group they had some very insensitive and insulting remarks about the patients. And after the tour was completed, the visitors were introduced and met with various members and staff of the mental hospital itself in the canteen. Okay. The unkind with this, the person who's always asking these insensitive and insulting comments, the very unkind person, he started chatting with the security guy there. Okay. The security person was actually a very kind and wise ex-policeman. Now he asked him, "Are they all sick and crazy loonies in here then?" The security staff replied, "Only the ones who failed the test." So this man is very curious. You know, there are a lot of curious people in this group as well. So he says, "Okay, so what is this test?" And then the security replies, "Well, we show them a bath, which is filled with water, a large bucket, a large cup, and a spoon, which is what is there on the screen. We then ask them, what is the quickest way to empty the water in the bath?" Okay. And any guesses? Anyone wants to answer that?
Open the drain.
Okay. This is one clever group. Huh? Okay. So this man was not as clever. And what he said was, I think that's a very simple question. And he says, the normal thing to do is use the bucket, right? And then the chief says, no, the normal one say pull the plug. So who spoke? Who answered the question?
Ma'am, Kunal.
Kunal. So you are completely normal. You don't have to go even 2 kilometers near Kir Park Mental Hospital. Okay.
Actually used to live there.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, near Kir Park.
Were you a staff member or were you a patient?
I'm a resident of Kir Park.
Okay. So unfortunately, this man he gave the response as the bucket, and then the chief looks at him and says, you know, the normal ones say the plug, but you said the bucket. Should I just go and check if there is a bed free for you? Okay. And that's how the story goes. Now, why am I talking about this story? The very fact that it is very easy for all of us to point at others and say, you're not good at this, you know, being very critical about things. I wish the country was different. I wish politicians were different. I wish, you know, a lot of wishes as well. And the other aspect being saying, oh, my parents are not so good. My teachers, look, they should be having more energy. We don't know what kind of things that we always keep pointing fingers at others. But the most difficult thing to do is to look at our own selves and say, what's really happening with us? Yeah, what is something that we need to change or we need to improve? And that's why self-awareness and personal growth becomes important. Yeah. Now, I'm just going to show you a model. This is what is called as Freud. Sigmund Freud is one of the, again, the pioneer psychologists who came up with a psychoanalysis approach to psychology. Okay. This is called the theory of the human mind. And what he basically said was there's only 5%, which is the tip of the iceberg, which all of us are aware of ourselves. Yeah. 95% of the things about us, we actually don't know. And that's what he calls as the unconscious mind. Yeah. And this 95% is what controls our life. Can you imagine that? That 5% is all that we know about ourselves. But the 95% of what we don't know about ourselves is what controls everything that happens to us in life. Everything that we do, our responses, our reactions, our relationships. Yeah. So to that extent, self-awareness is therefore extremely critical, and it's an extremely critical skill set for us to develop. Okay. Now, I thought I'd just share with you a very small and but very easy concept to understand. This is a model that you can use for, you know, in many ways. You can apply it to enhance your self-awareness. You can apply it to even look at personal growth. And I thought I'll make this the key for today's discussion. Okay, this is called Johari's window. It's named after two people, Joe and Harry, and that's why it's called Johari's window. Now, it's a very simple model in which what they talk about is, you know, there are things that we know about ourselves and there are things that we don't know about ourselves. So he calls it, you know, in that matrix, known to self and the unknown to self box. There are also ways and means in which people see us. A lot of people see us differently from what we think about our own selves, right? I don't know if you've had that experience. So a lot of times what has happened is I have always thought of myself as somebody who's very let's say very friendly. I mingle easily with people, until one such time that somebody walked to me and say, oh, are you an introvert? And I was like, oh, how did you get to know? Because that is something that I've never disclosed to people. And I've been quite friendly and chatty with people. So, but people can see us in a different way from what we present ourselves, right? And that's why this model becomes useful, okay? So if you see four windows in that box, the first one is called the open self. In another word, it's also called as the public self. This is the part of us which we also know about us, which others also get to see, okay? For example, it can be something like, if you've seen me, I think all of you noticed that I have a shorter hair, and all of you noticed that I'm sitting in a room which is painted blue, right? So these are things which are visible and which are available for people to see. Also things like, for example, the introduction that was shared in the beginning of this session, those are things that I already shared with you. You heard it, and therefore to that extent, you are aware of it. So it's called the open self, okay? Now the second quadrant is called the hidden self. Now the hidden self is something that others don't know, because we keep it hidden from them, but we know, yeah? If I were to give an example, what have I not shared in the introduction? So, something, okay. So I have a daughter, and that my daughter's name is what flashed in the sign-in, which her name is Anushka, right? So until I tell you, this is an information that is not available to you, which is a part that I have not shown, right? Now that I have chosen to say it, that goes into my open self, because you become aware of it, yeah? So to that extent, have you all got it? So far, open self and hidden self?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yes, ma'am. Super. Now we go to the third window, which is what we call as the blind self. Now the blind self is something where, we don't know things about us, but others can see, right? So there are surprise moments where someone walks in and says, some nice things about you. So they may say, I'm so glad that you were there, because if you weren't there, then I wouldn't have passed through a tough phase, yeah? And you're like quite surprised, but you're pleasantly surprised. And you didn't know so far that somebody values your presence, right? So that's what we call as the blind self, okay? Now, the undiscovered self, or also what is called as the self that is unknown, is something that we also don't know and others also don't know about us. Okay, so that is the information which is in that iceberg that I showed you in this screen, which is the 95% part. Most of the unknown is present in the lower area of the iceberg as far as a human psyche goes. Okay, now I'm just going to open it up very quickly if there are any questions on this, because this is the most crucial concept. Any quick questions? We'll take a minute and see if there are questions. Okay, so I'm guessing that it's quite clear to all of you. Okay, so just to check and see if you understood, I'm going to ask you something. Just give me a second. Okay, so anyone from the group, tell me one thing that, everyone knows about you. Something that is quite obvious and everyone knows, and they're aware of that aspect of you.
I'm a chatterbox. I speak a lot. Literally everybody knows.
Okay. Thanks, Harini. Okay. Anyone else?
I prefer my loyalty high above everything.
Sorry, Devang, you have to say that again.
I prefer my loyalty high above everything.
Loyalty, you said loyalty, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you are a very loyal person. Yeah, and that's something that you also know and others also know about you. Praneet.
Jovialness, ma'am.
Sorry?
Jovialness.
I didn't get that. Tell that again.
Jovialness, ma'am.
Jovialness. Okay. So you think that you're jovial. I hope others also think the same. Do others agree that Praneeth is jovial?
Yes, ma'am.
Any one of his friends?
Yes, we all agree, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. So now that is what we call as the open self. This is something that you also are familiar and you know that this is a part of you, and others also see it in the same way, which is A is equal to B here. If A is what you think about yourself and B is what others think about you, it matches. Okay. That is called as the public or the open self. Now, the second question from my end would be, tell one thing that, you know, others don't know about you. And they will be surprised if they hear it right now. Anyone who is willing to, you know, risk and say it now. Can be a good thing also. Everyone is in the open self.
Ma'am, can you repeat the question again, ma'am?
Tell one thing that... others don't know about you, but you have it. Maybe a hidden talent, maybe a strength, or maybe a personality type, maybe even something that you like or you don't like, but others don't know that about you.
Maybe about
me. I used to write poems in my childhood days.
Okay, Devang, right. So you are a talented poet, which, okay, others, please make note. Praneeth.
Maybe about my patience, ma'am. They don't know about my patience, but I have much more patience to do what I want.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a very good thing to now have shared with people, right? So the moment both you, Devang and Praneeth, you share this part of you, it goes into the open self, right? So to that extent, your open self has maybe increased by an inch. Yeah, so you have expanded that window. Okay.
Now, Priya, just a second. Sorry to interrupt. Actually, there are second years who have not opened up at all.
Okay.
The third years are only talking to you. Yeah. So maybe, you know, as a teacher, you have to probably pull them up. Second years, ninga pesalam. I want you also to interact. The guest speaker is for all third years, second years and first years. It's not necessarily for third years alone. So please talk or interact rather.
First year?
You can continue, Priya.
Sure. Okay, cool. This next question, can someone from the first year and second year group answer? Tell one thing about anybody here in the group which you probably like or admire about them. This should be easy. This is your chance. Go for it. Is there nothing that you admire about anyone? Something that you like?
Everyone is busy with their mobile phones always. They don't observe at all.
Okay. So I'll open it up. So anyone who wants to answer, even the third years included.
Ma'am, I usually admire from Tyagarajan, ma'am.
Okay.
How the hell he can manage all the stuffs that sitting before a computer for more than 5 hours and spending a lot of time on technical side. It's like a hell for me, ma'am.
Wow, superb. So I have Tyagu, you heard that, right?
Yes,
okay, superb. Right, so that's the example of... you know, something, Tyagu, did you know that about yourself? That you are being admired for your, you know, your patience and your ability to stay with technology and facilitate so many things.
Actually, I learn more about every day, every second I need to learn about the technology, because in future, it will be holding the world. So I need to learn more.
Totally, I completely agree with what Mugilan shared just now. He gave you a compliment Yeah, something that he says that he admires about you, right? So in hearing that, how do you feel?
I didn't expect from them.
Yeah, so it's unexpected, right? And this is we put in this particular window, which we call the blind self. Some things that we don't know about our own self and someone else has noticed. And that's what your friend there shared for you, right? Okay. So the undiscovered self alone is an area that we call, an area of self-discovery, exploration. And there are many ways in which you can expand this window as well. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about next. Okay. What do we do with this model? Why this particular model and what do we do? How can we use it for our personal growth? Right? Because that's also the topic for the day for all of you. Now, one of the most simplest things, if you just see, all of you are physics students. If you just see that particular matrix, which is there, that particular window, which is there on your screen, the logical thing is to say that if I want to improve my self-awareness, the window one, which is the open free area, is what I need to expand. Okay. Now, there are two ways, not two, there are three ways in which you can expand that area. You can expand that window one. One, you can expand it into the blind area. Okay, you can expand it into the hidden area, which is the window three. Or you can expand it and make more area, which is the window four, the unknown area, right? Now, if you were to expand your self, the open or the free area, which is the area that you know, and into the area that you others don't know, which is the hidden area. One way of doing it is what you did just now, like what some people said. Like one person said that he used to write poems, right, as a kid. Another person said that he has a lot of patience, yeah, and that is something which others didn't know, but they know now. So technically, what you have done is you have moved that particular line between one and three, and you have expanded in your open self in a little more into the hidden area. This is what we call as self-disclosure or self-exposure, which is, you know, little bit not doing damaging stuff like saying I'm bad at this and I'm not good at this, because that can be damaging. But things which are useful for people to know, things which will help you grow in life, right? And in fact, I'm thinking, for example, somebody who has a lot of patience will do so well in so many different domains or different professions, yeah? So it's a good to know thing that you can make available or tell another person, right? That's what we call as the self-disclosure mechanism. Okay, so you got that bit, everyone? Any doubts, anything clear? Yeah, expanding from window one into three.
Yes, ma'am. No doubt, sir.
Thanks. Okay. Now let's look at the second one, which is expanding your open area a little more to the right side, which is into your blind area. Now the blind area is something that you don't know, but others know about you, right? For example, I don't know who shared about Tiagu, what you admired about Tiagu. Is giving him a feedback, which is a very good feedback that you gave to him about how he adapts and uses technology so well and managing it for such a long duration of time in a day, right? That feedback that you gave, that positive feedback that you gave, helped Tiagu understand a little more about his own strength, right? So what you have basically done is by giving that feedback, you help Tiagu expand this open area, which is window one, a little into window two, which is the blind area. Any doubts on that? Is that clear? The second part?
Clear, ma'am.
This is what we call as the method of feedback. For example, you know, you have teachers after your exams. Sometimes teachers call and discuss your answer sheets with you and say, you know, or even getting marks on the answer sheet. It's actually a feedback to your performance, right? And you can look at and say, oh, here's a diagram that I have messed up, or I probably could have written it in bullet points, or I could have added a little more content into this answer, right? That's feedback that you have got. So to that extent, your blind area starts reducing when you get feedback from others, because basically you're just having another hold the mirror for you, and you're allowing yourself to be to understand those aspects which you earlier didn't know about yourself. Okay, now the third part, which is the third part of expanding your self-awareness or your open area, is the area into window four. Okay, now how do we do that? There are two, three ways. One, I don't know if there's a practice that is followed in your college. A lot of teachers in different academic institutions use observers. Okay, now the idea of using observers is for them to see how the teacher is teaching, especially in the beginning years of teaching, right? And the observer then shares and says, oh, so you know, you did this well, you can do a little better on this. And each time the observer shares this, the person who didn't know anything about this particular aspect about his or her attributes gets to know about that. That's what we call as others' observation. And that's one area. It's like feedback, but how it is different is even the observer didn't know till such time that they observe, right? The second way in which you expand it is what we call as discovery, which is basically, you know, suddenly like coming up and exploring and discovering. A lot of people who come to me for therapy or coaching, even leaders in organizations, what they're basically trying to do through coaching is to understand a little more about yourself. And I have met them for the first time, so even I don't know. So we are doing a joint discovery. That's what we call as shared discovery. So we look at different aspects and we start understanding what is about this person, right? What are the skills? What are the strengths? What are the gaps? So you seem to be somebody who's very patient, which means that you will be able to manage conflict resolution a little better, right? This is what we call as discovery or shared discovery, or sometimes even sitting with your own self. I don't know how many of you do meditation or mindfulness practice. Anyone does? I'm quite curious about that. Does anyone do meditation?
Yoga.
Super.
Sorry, namaskar.
Yeah, okay. So when you're with your thoughts and when you're doing those asanas, there are a lot of things that occur to us, which otherwise it doesn't come to us, right? Those are what we call a self-exploration, self-reflection, introspection, or self-discovery. And that's how we expand the open area into the unknown area. Did you all get that part?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah? Okay, let me give you examples. Okay, so to just make it a little more clear for you. Now, one of the things that I did when I was working in the corporate setup, I was heading human resources for an organization. And when I was there as in my job, the CEO of the company with whom I used to work closely, because as a department head, I have to meet the leadership of the organization to discuss a lot of strategy as far as people go, okay, in the organization. Now, I had no idea until my CEO said, you know what, when I was sharing some ideas about some engagement activities for the employees, he said, you should be a consultant, okay? And I was a little shocked. I'm like, because until then, it never occurred to me that I can actually be very good at consulting. Now, consulting would mean that I don't have to necessarily work in an organization. I can work with multiple organizations and offer them expertise, my expertise as a service. Okay, so 1 year after that, I quit my job and I started my own consulting firm. Okay, that's called Punctuate Consulting. And I work with many organizations for their culture, their change, their leadership organization. Now, that is something that I had no idea that I had as a strength until this man told me, right? And it was such a valuable feedback that was given, which is from my blind area, something which I don't know, that was so useful. And there is no turning back ever since. And I've done pretty well in that field, because, and it seemed like a very useful feedback for me, which ended up turning my life around, right? So I don't anymore work full-time in organizations. I have my own independent practice. Yeah. Now that's one example of how feedback can improve your self-awareness and help you personally grow. Okay. Now here's another example. And this is an example of a movie star, which is on the hidden area, which is the self-disclosure part. Okay. How many of you have heard of Sylvester Stallone?
Yes, ma'am, I've heard of him.
Haba, at least one of you have heard. Others, I hope you all heard. Do you all know Rambo, Rocky movies?
Yes.
Yeah, he also came to some Hindi movie sometime back, right?
Yeah, he came in Cliffhanger.
Yeah, he was an excellent, not just an excellent actor. He personally had a lot of strengths from, he was fantastic with boxing. And he used that as a strength in the movies too. So a lot of the movie scenes that you see from his movies, they're actually real, okay? And he's also a stunt artist. I think most of the stunts that are there in his movies are done by him, okay? Now, here's his story. Now, when he was very young and he'd not even got into movies as yet, this was a time when his baby was on his way, his wife was pregnant, and he hardly had any money to even pay the rent on his apartment. Now he sat down, and that's when he wrote the screenplay for his first movie, which is called Rocky. Okay, and he wrote it in 4 days' time, which is a record time for anyone to have even written a screenplay. Now all the producers loved it, and they all gave him a lot of money for the story. But the only downside was they were only interested in buying the story, okay? And Sylvester Stallone actually refused it. Now, he told them, I am willing to sell you the story if you take me in as the lead actor. He basically self-disclosed and said, I am not just good at writing, I am also good at acting. And that's the aspect which the producers didn't know. But most of the producers refused, until he hit it big with one person where he also had to partly produce the movie. And then after that, there was no turning back. The movie was a big hit. And I think there was a sequence till Rocky 4 or 5. Yeah. And it shot him up, it literally skyrocketed him to fame. And Hollywood, in fact, I can't imagine Hollywood without Sylvester Stallone anymore. Right. Now, this is an example of how self-disclosure can also change and help you grow personally. It really defined the success in his life as far as Sylvester Stallone goes. Yeah. Now, is that something that's sitting with you? Are you clear with the hidden area part, the self-disclosure part?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Now, what about the unknown area? This is a little dicey, right? This is something that others also don't know. We also don't know. And I just thought I'd leave you with this one tiny little story. Okay, this is the Sylvester Stallone scene, which is from the movie Rocky. Okay, now here's this story. Now, this is a story about a Japanese Zen master. Okay, the picture that you see, the caricature that you see, is of this Japanese Zen master. His name is Nanin. Okay, and this is a true story, by the way, and it's a very popular story, and it's very popular amongst trainers as well. He lived in this what was called as the Meiji era. It was in 1868 to 1912. That's his period. Now he suddenly had a visitor from a university professor. He was actually a university professor who came to him, and he said, you know, Nanin, I want to acquire Zen. Okay. Now, Nanin said, okay, let's first have tea. And he started serving tea. He poured the tea into this university professor's cup, and he kept on pouring. And the professor is watching. The tea is overflowing. It is spilling all over, until at one point the professor could not take anymore. And he said, can you see? It's overfull. It can't take any more, right? And the moment he said it, Nanin looked at him and said, like this cup, you are also full of your own opinions and speculation. And how can I show you Zen unless you first empty your cup? Yeah, which basically means that if we need to make space for self-discovery as well, we need to make space for taking in others' feedback, taking in others' observations that are shared. And unless we are humble and open enough to receive, there is no way that we can acquire Zen. And in this case, Zen is your own self-awareness. Yeah? Is that something which is making sense?
Yes, ma'am, it does, absolutely.
Yeah, right?
Ma'am.
Yes.
And one more thing, ma'am. This same scene is shown in 2012 movie, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, super. Which movie is that?
2012, ma'am.
Oh, 2012. The movie 2012 itself. Okay.
I yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah.
There's and a scene. Exact scene.
Okay.
A disciple comes and says to the monk that a big tsunami is coming this way, and he'll start pouring the same tea and said, your mind is overflowing with emotions. Just empty the cup. He'll say, ma'am.
Superb. Thanks for sharing that. Absolutely. Because this is in fact something that we share with a lot of people who have a very closed mind. And if your mind is closed, you remember the first quote? So if you think you know everything, you're actually stupid, because then you're not open to learning. And if you're not open to learning about your own self, there is no way and no point in us talking about self-awareness, right? And there is no way that one can personally grow, right? So, and that's why the story I thought was important to share with you, okay? Now, I'm coming to the last part of our conversation. Now, this model is fine. So all of you know what Johari's model is, and you can use it and see how you can apply to enhance your self-awareness. But I thought I'd leave you with just one tip, right? One small place to start, right? Now, this is about asking questions that will also help you with personal growth. Okay, so I'm just sharing this particular quote, and I'll just read it for you. So if I had, which is what Albert Einstein says, and this is, I'm sure that Einstein is quite popular among all of us physicists. I myself, I'm a graduate in physics. So this is somebody who's very close to heart. Yeah. What he says is, if I had an hour to solve a problem and my life depended on the solution, I would spend the first 55 minutes determining the proper question to ask. Because if I get the question right, I know I can solve the problem in less than 5 minutes. Yeah. And this is so very true. And this is the power of being able to ask right questions, even for your own self-awareness and personal growth. Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to quickly share with you of, there was about a research that was conducted. This was conducted by one of those prominent universities like Harvard and I guess Michigan. So now what they did was they went around, they took this area of self-awareness and they questioned some 1,500 odd people in their sample. Okay. Now, and they, when they explored and they found that there were only 5% who were actually self-aware. Now all these people who came in, the 1,500 people who came in for that research, they claimed to be self-aware, but the fact is only 5% actually turned out to be self-aware. Okay, and that is the, that's the sad state of affairs, because a lot of us assume that we know many things about us, but we actually don't know. And I'll again just bring you back to that iceberg, the Freudian iceberg that I showed of 95% being unconscious to us, right? And keep that in mind. Now, a part of that research, they also found, what is the difference between the self-aware 5% and the rest of the people? What is it that they're doing that is helping them with self-awareness and personal growth? How come they are more successful in life? And when they did that, they realized that there were only about some 100-150 people who had mentioned that they asked the question why. Okay, but most of the others actually said that they asked the question what. Now, what's the difference? Now, when you ask the question why, for example, when you say, why am I feeling this? How come I'm feeling depressed? Right? Why am I feeling sad? Now, these are questions that you're basically asking from a place that you don't know to a place that you don't know. Basically, you're asking your unconscious self, which is not going to give you an answer. And whatever answer that your mind pops, for example, let's say if I'm thinking, why am I feeling sad? And the answer that comes to me is something like, oh, maybe I have low energy, right? And that need not be true. I may not have energy that day because maybe sugar levels dropped, I didn't eat food, and that's the reason why. And not because I'm a person with low energy, okay? Now, that's what why questions do. They basically give you answers which you cannot validate. You don't have facts to establish them. And the mind is very good at inventing answers and throwing it up to the extent that you start assuming that you are somebody who has low energy, okay? And you need not necessarily be that, right? So instead, what is good to ask is a what question. For example, if I were to instead ask, what are the times that I feel sad, all the times that I felt sad have in common? Yeah, now that's a useful question to ask. And maybe my mind will wonder, put together the different days when I remember being sad and say, oh, you know what? I bloody skipped breakfast on that morning. And that's the reason why I'm not able to have so much energy. Okay, now that's an answer that I can work on and use it for personal growth. And that's useful as well. It can help me keep myself confident and not beat myself down to say, oh, it's because I am a person who's somebody who has low energy, which is not true, right? Now, that's the difference between the why and the what question. So I'm going to leave that with you as a tip or a technique to use for building both your self-awareness as well as helping you with personal growth, okay? Now, I'm just going to, I thought I'll also tell you an example of how a what question changed a person's life. And it actually helped him become extremely successful in life. Now, anyone recognizes this man?
Maybe founder of KFC, I think so.
Oh, absolutely. You know, who answered this?
Mugilan, ma'am.
Mugilan. I was hoping this will be somebody from second year or third year. So first year, yeah. Second year, first year, you decided to be silent, I guess. Okay. So this is Colonel Sanders. And as Mugilan rightly said, he is the founder of KFC. He's the one who started KFC and is even till date, he's a big, you know, he's one of the richest men in the world. Now, here's his story. Okay, just for people who didn't know, that's the logo, which is based on him. And you see KFC written there. Now, just a little bit about him. You know, when he was 6, he lost his father. And at around the age of 13, he actually quit school. Later, he gave a false birth certificate when he was just even about 15 years to join the army. And of course, he had to be kicked out of the army. Then at about 17, he actually ended up losing 4 more jobs that he tried doing. 18, he got married. Now, that's not something that I will ever invite you people to think, but those days and Colonel Sanders. So he got married at 18. He became an insurance sales agent and he failed again. Okay. He applied for law school and he was rejected. Yeah. He became a cook and he was a dishwasher at a small cafe. Now, he took retirement doing all these small jobs at the age of 65 and he got only $105 as pension. Okay. Now, after so many failures and at that age of prime age of 65, he decided that he will commit suicide. Okay. So he sat under a tree and he started writing his will. And when he was just about to start writing, something occurred to him. And instead he wrote, not asking why did I fail? He didn't ask those questions. He didn't ask, why did I fail? Why have I not been successful? That was not the question that he asked. Instead he wrote, what would I have accomplished with this life? There has, there's much more that I could have done. And if there was one thing that I could do better, what is it? And the first answer that came to him was cooking. Okay. Because he loved cooking and he was a regular cook and he used to cook several dishes in his house as well. And he has worked these small time jobs as a cook as well. Right. The moment cooking came as an answer, he borrowed some money against his pension check and he went and fried up some chicken and used that recipe. And he started selling to local neighbors. And then slowly he grew the business. And now it's something that everyone talks about, which is KFC. Okay. Now, if he had, even in that moment when he was sitting and writing that letter, continued to ask a why question, he may probably not be around for us to talk about him. But he chose to ask a what question, which was, what am I actually good at? What can I do? What have I not done? And that gave him an answer from which there was no looking back. Yeah. And that's a success story of how a what question can actually help you with personal growth and success in life. Yeah. So is that story something that's useful for all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, thank you so much. Now, and we're kind of now at the end of the session, so we have just about a few minutes left. So I thought I will leave this session on a lighter note, which is this, okay? So warning, people please reduce a little bit of volume because in our side of town, our heroes don't speak, they scream. Okay, so just be aware, protect your ears. One awesome psychoanalysis. Agree? Yeah, but not in the way that was said, which was in a lighter note. But that's the extent of self-awareness that he proclaims and says whatever it is that he's saying in such a dramatized way. But imagine if we even attempt at doing a small bit of that, a small bit of that self-awareness, how powerful it can be for our own growth. Yeah. So I'm leaving you with this last question for all of you, which is, let us look at it. I am, it's two of the most powerful words, for what you put after them actually shapes your reality. Agree?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. You have tried this and experienced it.
Yeah, totally. And just take a moment and see, and maybe spend a little time even after the session. Take your time and see what's an answer that you want to put after I am. Yeah. If you ask me, I would put something like, I am a curious learner. I am an enthusiastic person. I am, I have zest for life. And these are things that actually help change my life around and maybe help me become whatever accomplishment that I've had so far in my life, right? Now, and that's what I would leave you with, okay? So we are at the close. So I'm going to wish you all, just stay safe, be healthy, take care of yourself. And I'm just stopping the screen share. If there's any questions that anyone wants to ask, please do ask. Or if there's anything that you want to share as to how you felt, what is it that you're taking back? What was useful for you? That's also open. That also you can share.
Thank you, ma'am. Your talk was highly thoughtful and enthusiastic. So let's move on into an interactive session. Those who have any questions, kindly raise your hands. Or else post your questions in the chat box with your name and class.
Ma'am, I would like to ask some question, ma'am.
Yes, yes, Mugilan.
I heard someone, ma'am. He's actually a calm and introvert kind of person, ma'am. And suddenly he actually changed his entire mentality and become a such kind of a stubborn and a leadership. How to say that, ma'am? He gained a lot of leadership qualities, ma'am. Is that any specific key to develop the leadership qualities? Like,
absolutely. That's a skill set that can be learned, Mugilan. If you put your mind to it, there are, basically, what does leadership mean? One, it means that you need to have a certain presence. You will need to be good at communication skills. You will need to have the ability to, take along people, right? That people are open to being and working with you, right? And those are skills that can be developed. And another thing that you shared is you said that he was earlier introverted and calm and he later became a leader. Now, it does not mean that introverted people cannot be good at leadership. I'm personally extremely introverted and throughout my life. But what we call as adaptability, and that somebody also said that I can adapt, right, in the earlier part of the session. Adaptability is what keeps us successful in organizations or in any work or any field that we choose to be in. Okay. Now, adaptability is also what can help a person choose certain skills and competencies that he can learn. Yeah, and leadership is one of them. Okay, so it's not difficult. But if you, and sometimes it can happen you know, by itself. For example, I had no idea that I could be a good leader until in college, one of my ma'ams pointed out and said, why don't you contest for the, you know, the union elections? And then, of course, I went on to be the secretary in the second year, went on to be the president in the final year. I had no idea because I'm quite the shy person. I like to sit behind and just, you know, just keep myself invisible. And this was again a feedback, which was one of the teachers pointing out and saying, no, I think you will be a good leader. I trusted her word. And after that, I saw that was an useful thing to develop within an organizational work. Yeah. Very good question, Mugilan. Thanks for asking.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, I have a question before that. Thank you, ma'am. This was really a wonderful session. And that what instead of why was really like I realized that many times we only ask why to ourselves instead of what. So that was very nice, ma'am. And my doubt is that we always, like as you said, I am this, like we train our subconscious by saying some things, whatever we need to achieve, ma'am. But at that time, sometimes what happens, some inner voice, like we have some negativity inside, which is, no, you can't do this. Even like we like train it so much, at some point, what happens is we are unable to stay so positive to our subconscious. So what can be done to do that, ma'am?
Okay. Harmi, that's a very good question to ask, but something which takes, you know, lifelong years of practice too. But to give you one simple response to that, that voice is what we call as inner critic. Okay. It's a critical voice, right? Who constantly keeps criticizing us and stops us from doing things, right? One of the ways in which you can try as a technique itself is to see if you can reduce the volume of that voice. Yeah. Or you can challenge that voice by saying, okay, so you're saying that, like, for example, if let's say that I want to learn dance, okay, and my inner critic is saying, come on, you cannot learn dance. You have two left foot. How are you even going to learn dance, right? Now, one thing that I can do is I can reduce the volume of that voice in my head and or I can ignore it, or I can say, you know what, it's okay. Even if you think that I'm not going to be good at learning dance, I'm going ahead, which is challenging that voice. Okay, that will mean that whatever that voice is sitting with, whatever emotion, maybe it's fear or maybe, you know, it's some kind of disappointment, whatever that voice is sitting with, you are learning to challenge and confront it and go ahead with what you think you want to do. And you can always try. And when you try and you realize, oh, I'm not able to actually learn dance, it's okay. But you did put your effort through it, right? Or it can turn around and you actually realize that you're good enough to dance with Ricky Roshan. We never know, right? So, and that's one way that you can fight inner critic voices, Harini.
Sure, ma'am. I'll just try and I'll get back to you with the positive results.
Yeah. Ma'am, there is a question in a chat box from Sandhya, ma'am.
Yes, Sandhya. I'm just seeing that question. How to overcome hesitation? Right? That's the question, right? Okay. Now, see, one of the things that you can start with is to look at what is actually behind that hesitation. What is that hesitation trying to do? Psychologically, a lot of times hesitation is protecting you from feeling ashamed. Yeah. Which means that you already decided that you're not going to do something well. And when you, and look at how it snowballs, that whole chain of reactions. So I can, maybe I'll give you an example. Let's say that there is a program happening in college, okay? And you want to participate, but you're hesitating because, and it can be any program, maybe it's a quiz program. And you're hesitating and you're sitting with that hesitation and finally you decide not to do it. And it's your loss, right? Now, if I want to overcome the hesitation, I can start with looking at what is that thing behind that hesitation? What is it doing to me? One, it can be that if I do and go and participate in the quiz, what if I don't answer all of these questions? Yeah. What if I give the wrong answers and people laugh at me? That is shame, right? So you're basically being afraid of shame. The other bit can be, you know, feeling inadequate about ourselves, thinking maybe I'm not prepared enough. So these are all stuff that can come up if you question your own hesitation. Now, if you want to get to overcoming it, again, it's very similar to what Harini had asked. It's to say that it's okay. You know, you challenge all that what if questions that come and say, so what? So what if these things happen? So what if I can't answer these questions? So what if I give the wrong answer? But you have to do it as a practice. And the moment you do it, then you will build the ability to overcome hesitation. Yeah? Was that useful, Sandhya?
Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm G. Kritik from second year, ma'am. First of all, is it audible?
Yes, please go ahead, Kriti.
So first of all, your talk was really good and kindling my a lot of thoughts into me, ma'am. And what I felt was, I'm a person who observe a lot more than reciprocating things to others. So so far, I was thinking that I observe a lot of things and used to spend time in thinking about whether this way developing myself into it by thinking of myself other than interacting with people. So through your talk, what I get to know was through interacting we can learn about ourselves in a higher percentage. So it was really useful, ma'am.
Okay, thanks, Kriti. Yeah, if I were to just add to what you said, Kriti, observation just, meets maybe 0.5% of self-awareness. Okay, what is more useful sometimes is to ask. When you ask, you get feedback. When you ask, you get observations. The other bit is to also tell, and which is when you talk about your strengths, you talk about your talents, that also helps you with your awareness and personal growth. Yeah, and that's what we spoke about through that model as well. Yeah, thanks.
Yes,
that second year student spoke.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am?
Good afternoon, ma'am. Yes.
Ma'am, I'm Harini from second year.
Yes, Harini.
I have a question. It's a request, actually. I searched about you on the internet. It says that you are an extreme believer in physics and metaphysics. I want to know, what is your view about metaphysics?
Okay, so I can actually give another hour lecture on metaphysics. So I'll keep it short, because what the very basis, I think, for all of psychology, one of those things, in fact, that I also tell my friends, my group of college friends from physics as well, is all that we learn in physics is actually what we learn even in spirituality and what we actually learn in psychology too. Yeah, so in physics, basically what you're doing is you're studying nature, which is the nature that is around us in the environment, the world. But in psychology, we are again studying nature. We are studying nature of psyche. We are studying nature of relationships. So it's not very different. So I have found that my understanding with physics actually helps me with this field as well, in both training and in psychology. Now, metaphysics is basically just lifting yourself a little higher and to get a larger perspective about things, right? And what it does is, visually just imagine, let's say that you're an eagle and you're floating over in the sky and you're watching the ground. Now, when you go a little higher, there's a lot more space and your view of things actually broaden. The view is like this, right? The focal length becomes larger, right? Now, when you're viewing it larger, it gives you a lot more perspectives. And that's why metaphysics is beautiful. I so totally love it. And what was more interesting for me is, and the arachamave arakranga we say, right? It's the same thing, because I think all that we are learning, we are discovering, we are trying new, we are writing about, is something which is already there in our scriptures. And we're just redoing the same stuff. We're just presenting it differently. We're talking about different concepts and stuff. It's everything written, yeah. All our scriptures, in fact, Hindu scriptures, even biblical scriptures, they all have it there, right? And in fact, one thing that also came to me is Bhagavad Gita is actually your entire scripture which presents things about self-awareness. In fact, there is a complete step to how you can improve your self-awareness. Why is it important? How can you do it? What are different ways in which you can do it? And how you become what they call as the sthita purush, right? So that's metaphysics. So I'll stop with that. Otherwise, I think the teachers will come back to me and say, no, can't extend the time. Yeah, I hope that is good. Okay, so Praneet has asked, combination of adaptability, patience, leadership skills is enough to sustain in workspace. Well, at least to begin with, yes. If you're looking at growth, Praneet, absolutely, because the two most important skill sets in organization is self-awareness. In fact, it is a recent trend. Morning when I woke up, I read one article in HBR, which they post every day. And today's article, coincidentally, was about self-awareness and how individuals who are not very self-aware, they actually are not somebody who would make good team players. Okay, and they end up messing up performance rather. So self-awareness and adaptability, if you have, you will do phenomenally well in any field, in any kind of work area. And of course, which means that rest of the things like patience and tolerance and humility, these are things that will facilitate your growth mindset. Yeah. And it's definitely a part of the leadership skill competencies as well. Okay, so before okay, Praneet. Varani has asked how to maintain anger management towards negative situations, which is hard for most of us. Okay, so this is a topic by itself, Varani, but to answer in a simple way, where what you can begin with is usually that anger is because you think that there's something which is unfair that has happened, right? It's a question of unfairness. For example, somebody has not, let's say in a big way, if I'm angry at the government today, I'm angry because they have not done something, they have not done governance properly, right? Now, I feel that they have therefore been unfair to their job. Now, every time I experience unfairness, anger comes in. Now, one of the myths about anger is it always has to be controlled. That's not true. What you need to do is learn to manage how you express anger, right? Because anger is one of the most beautiful emotions, and anger is the emotion which is behind change. A lot of change that you see in the world which is happening is because somebody got angry about something which is not okay, and therefore they're doing something about it, okay? So it's a beautiful emotion. But expression of anger in an aggressive way, in a violent way, is what we say needs to be contained. Okay. And that's something that can be learned. And mindfulness helps, meditation helps to start with. Also, understanding your own story from where anger comes. Yeah. Maybe there is something that's individually affecting you. Now, if you address the root of it, then anger can be contained. Okay, so Vasant has said how to overcome negative situation. Okay, that's an interesting thing. So I don't know if have you heard of this thing called Stockdale paradox. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but if I would just quickly tell you, so this is named after one of the Vietnam War veterans. His name is Stockdale. And this is something that was that had become very popular in this book called Good to Great. Okay. Now, what Stockdale actually said was he was a prisoner of war during that Vietnam War time. He and his troops. And when they were held prisoners, I guess that'll also answer Neeraja's question. So what he basically said was, every day it was very difficult to go through because you're basically a prisoner and you don't know if you will ever be let free, right? Now, he said that he noticed two kinds of people in his group. Now, one set of people, they are these extremely positive kinds who said, I know that by Christmas we will all be free and I will be back home, in time for Christmas. Christmas came, they were not set free. Then they said, okay, we will wait till Easter. When I'm sure that by Easter, we will get free. Now, this is what we call as toxic positivity. It's just too much of positivity, which is being cut off from reality. Now, what Stockdale said was useful to get over that negative situation was a little bit of touch on reality too, which means that I'm not saying that I'm losing hope and faith that I will be set free. I do believe that I will be set free. but I'm also aware of what is the context now, what is reality now, right? And therefore, what is it something that I need to do? Now, this set of people who believed in a balanced view of reality and faith or hope are the ones who actually survived, and they were free. The ones who were extremely positive actually died because of heartbreak, yeah, because they could not take the disappointment, right? And therefore, if you were to overcome any negative situation, it just means that there is some amount of reality that you have ignored, and you need to account for that reality and see what you need to do about that. Some action, right, which will help in that direction. Now, while I hope that answers your question, Vasant, and just to complete the loop with Neeraja as well. So just very simply, Neeraja, we cannot definitely pretend to be positive. And very classic example is what is happening now with the pandemic, right? It's not possible to always keep positive and say, oh, I know that miraculously things will happen. We also needed to wear the mask. We also needed to keep that social distance. Those were things that helped protect us. But it did not mean that I lost faith in humanity and there will be no vaccine that will come, right? And that's happening. It may take time, but it will happen. But at the same time, I need to take these small little steps to keep myself and the people around me safe, right? And that's what we mean by balanced positive view, which is very different from toxic positivity, which is too much of positive thinking. So just to complete it, negative situation, first thing is to look at what's really happening. What about you contributed to the negative situation? And therefore, what can you do? All the what questions that are useful there. And therefore, to do realistic things while not losing faith. Okay, that's in response to those questions. Okay, so Praveen, your question says, I wonder why people are more inclined towards being a leader rather than focusing on being a good helper, fulfilling, understanding others' needs first. Okay, Praveen, in reality, it's a question of a growth phase, right? All of us start somewhere. It can't be possible that we become leader without having the experience, without having hands-on experience, right? Now, but when you grow and as you go up the ladder, you do, and it's not necessary that everyone becomes a leader or wants to become a leader, but there are certain roles or there are certain things which require those kind of leadership skills. Okay. And I completely agree with what you're saying is so team members are also required. So to be a good team member is also okay, right? As long as you know what your ambitions are. Like if I were to give my example of my husband likes to do independent work. He's while he works in organizations, he's not somebody who's very keen on being a leader. He likes to be an independent consultant and that's his choice. And he's a fantastic independent consultant. But at the same time, there is also a lot of leadership skills he has. Doesn't mean that he's not a good leader. And when he was given the opportunity to run a department, he did it fantastically well. So I guess it's a question of choice, Praveen, and choice at any point in time is something that will be available to you. Okay, so Abhijit says, is that anger can also help us if we use it in a positive way so that it will become, yes, absolutely. If anger is the first step to change, Abhijit, that's what I spoke about. What, and again, just to repeat myself, what you need to learn is methods and techniques and ways by which you don't let your anger harm another person or your own self, which is the expression of the anger. So if you explode, people around you are also going to be affected. At the same time, your own physiology gets affected. So just be mindful because a lot of physiological problems in our body starts with anger. Okay, so learning the art of expression of anger is very, very critical. Okay. Kriti says many leaders and CEOs in the past could have not got to know about all the process we learned through the session and more digitally. What are your thoughts? What they could have recognized in them for the small start, which will be portrayed very fictional in movies rather than process. Not understanding your question fully, but I'm just going to go with the first part. Kriti, do you want to just say what that question is? Can you just explain that a bit?
Oh,
what I was conveying is that people in the past would have not learned digitally through all these mediums like we are learning, how they could have recognized the talent in them, and they could have been getting success through it.
Okay, so even if you know, digital sources or digital ways of learning were not available, they definitely had people around them, right? There were wiser people who could share their thoughts, their wisdom, their observations. And there is a lot that you learn through experience too. So as you do something, you realize something, right? I remember one of those basic experiments that we did in school in physics, you know, with the one with the vernier calipers and screw gauge. It's not very easy to go and measure the thickness of say that small wire that we put in and we measure, right? But we learn through trial and error. And then we get it. And the whole concept of the measurement there is, again, trial and error. There's an error quotient there as well that we talk about, right? Now, and that's how they would have learned, Kriti. And if you remember what I said about what our scriptures actually have all that wisdom. And those days, luckily, they were quite blessed that they did not have mobile phones and stuff to keep distracting them. I'm sure that they would have read a lot. They would have heard people talk about things from scriptures. So there was a lot of knowledge and wisdom that was available. Now, what has changed of late is just the format of that knowledge. Like we get it through digital ways. There are lots of things that we see, saying like what you're saying, in movies, in learning content that's posted online as well, right? Now that format has changed, and that ways we are also lucky because. To that extent, there's a lot of exposure for wise and good intellectual and growth-oriented content. Yeah. Does that answer your question, Kriti?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Mugilan says to do that in large-scale leadership qualities are necessary. Oh, you're addressing Praveen. Yes. Okay, now, you know, since so many people have asked about leadership quality, I also want to say one thing that, you know, there's no such thing as being born as a leader and things like that. So you learn by way of experience. That is one thing. And each time when you're learning through observation, you're learning through feedback, and these skills can easily be developed. Yeah. And leadership quality is actually, if you break down, there is a lot of soft skills that fall under it. One and few of what I named, like self-awareness and communication skills. Another thing that we call as interpersonal skills, which means to be able to get along well with people, get along well with team. Yeah. Diplomacy. And those are all breakdown of leadership qualities. Yeah. So I just thought I'll add that element to your conversation. Kunal, what do you think is the best way to deal with failure? Oh, very simply, and the most common, words of wisdom that are available to everyone is to look at it as experience where you're learning something. In fact, the very example of, what can I share? There are lots of success stories. In fact, let's just take an example from movie itself, since all of you are movie buffs. If you know Amitabh Bachchan, right? Now, Amitabh Bachchan, it's not like overnight somebody, when he went and he asked for a chance in the movie, he was given. The first thing that he was told is, you have a horrible voice. That voice is not something that will suit the film screen, the movie screen. And can you imagine that? He has such a baritone voice, and to this day, I still remember his dialogue in the head from Kaun Banega Karodpati, where he says freeze kiya jaye. Though that's the kind of voice. There are the movie that you saw with Dhanush, that Hindi movie which was also dubbed in Tamil. There's a song that he sings. Can you imagine that he can sing a song, and only he could have done it because that voice suited that kind of lyrics so well, right? Now if he had just taken to heart that, yeah, I'm so tall, and people, the producers and directors have told me that I'm in screen presence will be hampered because of my height and because of my voice. And imagine that. And that would have, then we would have never been able to witness somebody like Amitabh Bachchan. Yeah. But instead, I think the very aspect of being able to, and maybe I'll offer this again as another technique. This is called what we call as mind filters. Okay. Now, one of the things where these kind of feedback is generally given, for example, the feedback that your voice is not suitable for the screen, your height is not suitable for the screen. You can start using filters which say, is this feedback useful for me? Do I want to do something about it? Yeah. And those filters help. For example, I may say, if I was Amitabh Bachchan, I would say, it's okay. So what if my height is this? I can't do anything about it. I can't cut my feet. And so what if my voice is like this? Let me see if I can use it as a strength. Right? Now, I am basically asking more questions to understand a bit more about that feedback by using these filters. Okay? And that's how you actually deal with failure. You look at them as feedback. You don't look at them as failure, which means that you have to develop a mindset or the tolerance to be able to stay in those few moments of where you're experiencing failure. And then to turn it around and say, what can I learn from this? And that's how experience is gained, Kunal. Yeah. Okay, Harni, in the matrix you showed, you said to improve our open free space. What are the advantages and what happens when we do that map? Okay. Now, the idea of improving that open free space or expanding it is what self-awareness is all about, Harni. Now, the advantages of doing it is, for example, feedback, good feedback that is shared. For the example that I gave, where my CEO told me that I have skill sets of being a good consultant. Now, that's a very good feedback. And if I had not done anything about it, it would have been a waste, right? Only to the extent of self-awareness, it's there in my open space now. But I didn't really use it. But what I chose to do, which is uniquely my story, which is, I said, okay, I want to do something about it. And can I see if I can build something on that particular thing, which someone is saying is my strength, right? Now, the moment I chose to do something about it and I did something about it, for me, life changed. And that's the advantage of expanding your open space. Now, there are no disadvantages there. Like there is always that concept of filters that you can use to see what is this something that I want to do something about. Yeah, can I use this strength? Where can I use this strength? Yeah, for example, I think initially somebody said that he's quite a patient person. Now, and for me, the first thing as a psychologist was, where does patience fit in, where it can be a strength? What kind of jobs, what kind of industries does patience actually help in that role? It's not necessary that everywhere patience is a primary requirement, right? Now, for example, in something like research, right? Some scientists and research, science and research, patience is a must. It's a critical skill set. Now, the moment I know that I have this as a strength, I can also now think about where I can use the strength. That's how improving open free space can be turned as an advantage for personal growth, Harini. Yeah, so, okay. Any more questions anyone wants to ask? That's all on the chat box. I hope I haven't missed any.
Anyone else have any questions? Feedback click is provided in the chat box. All the participants fill the feedback form. So let's proceed towards oath of thanks.
It is indeed my privilege to propose the oath of thanks for this session. I express my heartfelt thanks to today's speaker, Madam Priya Veeraraghavan, on behalf of my fellow student participants and professors, Department of Physics, for our interesting talk on self-awareness for personal growth. The movie references which you used to discuss about self-awareness made the session more engaging, ma'am. And talking about the Johari's window, which you used to explain about the concept of self-awareness, it gave us more broader view and a very easy understanding on self-awareness. Thank you, ma'am, for this session. I extend my sincere thanks to our secretary and principal for encouraging and supporting us to conduct these webinars. My big thanks to our professors, Department of Physics, for organizing such webinars. Last but not the least, I express my sincere thanks to our technical team and fellow participants
for their constant support and enthusiastic participation through the whole course of this webinar. Thank you all. Have a fantastic day.